Faced with aging and shrinking populations, some developed nations are looking to immigration to fill the labor force. Hello, I'm Arnold Neidem, and this is The Heat. Japan, which has been long opposed to widespread immigration, is starting to change its view and is studying a proposal that would allow more foreigners into the country with their families. The reason? An acute labor shortage. Like most developed nations, Japan is dealing with an aging population and declining births. It's a country where diapers for adults actually outsell diapers for babies. The reverse of this trend can be found in Africa. Sub-Saharan Africa is dealing with a population boom, and the continent will have to create jobs for its citizens or send them to countries thirsty for workers. To discuss this dynamic, let's bring in our panel. From Tokyo, Yoshikazu Kato is a research fellow at the Rakuten Securities Economic Research Institute. Zainab Usman is the director of the Africa program at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace here in Washington, D.C. Also here in D.C., William Lee is chief economist at the Milken Institute, and Remy Pierre is the senior partner at Embelli Advisory. He joins us from London. Welcome to all of you. Great to have you on the show. Yoshikazu Kato, let me start with you. Japan is looking at granting visas to foreigners and their families, but they will not be granted any kind of path to permanent residence in Japan. Is that good enough to attract workers to the country?
I don't think so. Of course, over the past couple of years, you know, Japanese government is promoting this kind of program, like, you know, internship program or like middle-skilled, you know, workers, something like that, and providing some visa. But it takes time, because now one reason is the COVID-19, because it is very difficult to, you know, welcome more people, more foreigners to come into Japan. So it takes time, and it's quite uncertain. But I think this policy orientation would be, you know, continued, you know, because there are some consensus in Japan to make our economy more sustainable. I think three increases: increase our, you know, labor force, and birth rate, and productivity. But productivity and birth rate, it is very unlikely to, you know, improve very, very quickly. So we need to open up our labor market. But as you know, Japanese society is very conservative, and, you know, in order to, you know, accept this new normal, you know, our, you know, citizen, you know, takes some process, you know, to adjust to a new normal. So we are discussing, we are doing something, but it takes time, and it arises a great controversy, particularly under the COVID-19, you know, that current circumstance.
Right. As you say, Yoshikazu, this program was introduced actually in 2018.
Yes.
There is an estimate that some sectors would see a shortfall in the number of workers they need by something like 345,000 workers. But according to Nikkei Asia, only 35,000 workers were in the program. So I guess the challenge for Japan is, how does the country make it more attractive for foreign workers?
Exactly. And of course, you know, Japan is a relatively converged society, and our central government is promoting this program. But the problem is how to, you know, how our, you know, companies and, you know, local societies, local government accompany this policies, you know, driven by central government. So this is a problem. You know, there is a consensus. We need to, you know, absorb more labor force from foreign countries like Vietnam, you know, Nepal or China. But the problem is how could our policy adjust to, you know, the working place, like factories or nursing home, because they need some interpreter, right? And they need some, you know, supporters to, you know, welcome these foreign workers. And because most of the Japanese cannot speak any English, you know, we only speak Japanese. So how to adjust or how to narrow these gaps, you know, so we need to do more in detail, technical basis, yeah.
Right. William Lee, the United States birth rate is also falling. It fell 4% in 2020. That hit a record low with 1.7 births per woman. That's not enough for the growth that the country is seeing right now. And as we are all aware, immigration is a political lightning rod in this country. It's very divisive, and people are either for it or against it. If the United States is unable to get people in sufficient numbers to come here, how will it affect the U.S. labor market?
Well, I absolutely agree that having an adequately trained labor force is absolutely critical to sustaining growth and a high productive and high income society. Here in the United States, it's not that people are against immigration. In fact, this is a nation of immigrants. What we are concerned about is the way in which immigrants get here and the legalities involved. And we want legal immigrants. So the real question is, how can we legalize immigration to make it effective and attract the talent around the world who could do best by coming here? I think for the United States, the real question is going to be, can we combine capital and labor and improve the talent of people who are in the United States, both domestically born and immigrants, to the point where they can contribute productively to the American life? And we've done so pretty well for the last 200 years. I think going forward, we're going to have to consider that even more because, as you say, birth rates are going down, but immigration will be the key to sustaining a high growth rate and high incomes.
Right, William, as you say, you know, it's getting legal immigrants into the country, but you said something right at the beginning of your answer, which is also very important, that is getting trained people into the country. So do you think in future there's going to be some kind of system of qualification? Because it hasn't been that way in the United States for a long time. But, I mean, other countries have that. You get points, and then if you qualify, you can enter the country. That doesn't exist in the United States, but do you think that will be the way ahead?
I think you misunderstood me. One of the things that the United States is uniquely good at is to train people once they get here. What we need are people who have raw talent, who want to learn and work hard. And the American way is to provide the schools, universities, job training, and experiences to make any worker, average worker, into a great worker if they're willing to try and work hard. That American dream is something that is persistent and continues today. And I think the legal obstacles we're facing right now is how to do it and how to implement that in the most cost-effective way.
Remy Pierre, let's look at the situation in Europe right now. In Germany, officials recently said that the country needs something like 400,000 new immigrants a year to fill jobs. There's also new immigration laws that have been passed in Germany to facilitate the rapid granting of visas to workers. What is the situation like, not just in Germany, but in Europe?
Well, it's actually a very diverse situation. I mean, you underline very interesting cases in the case of Japan and in the case of Germany, where there's clearly an economic point to be made about more immigration because there's a lack of educated workforce to be able to sustain the economy. At the same time, here in London, there's actually conflict between, you know, the United Kingdom and France about, you know, the ongoing immigration across the channel. And actually, last week, 28 people died in the channel trying to pass the frontier between France and England. And there's a strong, you know, rebuttal in the United Kingdom against immigration. The question here is there's two things, if I can just like broaden a little bit the topic. First of all, it's not only a question about economic versus, you know, whether it makes sense for the economy of host countries. It's also a question of integration and identity. And that's actually something that is very important in the series of ongoing elections or campaigns around Europe, where the question of, you know, which kind of immigrants you actually integrate and how you're able to make sure that they, you know, are part of a common, you know, cultural cradle that actually fuels a series of debates in Europe. At the same time, when you're looking at immigration out of emerging markets, you have to keep in mind that these are the most educated people that actually immigrate to first world countries or European countries, you know, furthering even more the gap of development between, you know, African nations or Latin American nations in the case of the US, which is the most, you know, trained population and the youngest and fittest population leave the countries, and therefore, you know, living in countries of origin, a population that is less educated and therefore is more and more in terms of dependency theory and underdevelopment compared to the first world.
Right, that's a very important point you raised there, Remy, and that is the question of integration and identity. And let me ask, Yoshikazu, let me ask you about that, integration and identity. You know, Japan is a very homogenous society, and as you were telling us a moment ago, most people in Japan just speak Japanese. They don't speak any other language. So getting foreign workers into the country, I mean, it's going to be a challenge, this question of integration and identity, isn't it?
Right, exactly. And I think, you know, in Japan, the word immigration policy is a kind of a taboo. You know, we cannot use immigration policy or immigration strategy because this would trigger Japanese, you know, identity. Because because it takes time. Because as you said, we are a very homogeneous society. So now we are on the stage of welcoming more, you know, working labor force from foreign countries. Or you know, welcoming more tourists into Japan to boost our economy, not that, you know, immigration policy. So I think I do not think in Japan now we are discussing about the relationship between identity and immigration policy, how to tackle, you know, the immigration policy or kind of barriers in terms of, you know, diversifying or opening up our national identity. I think now we are not on this stage. But now, you know, first of all, we can absorb more tourists. and then, you know, labor force, and then maybe in the future, you know, the immigration policy could be on the table, because, you know, our population peaked around our labor force of peaked around 80 millions in, I think, in 1995, but it will be down to 40 millions in 2060. So, you know, it's a reality. Japan is the most aging society. That is why, you know, even though this takes time, but we need to adjust to a new normal. You know, we need to discuss how our immigration policy goes on in terms of in diversifying our identity. You know, this is a very realistic problem here in Japan.
All right, let's bring Zainab Usman into the conversation. Zainab, great to have you with us. Welcome to the show. Let's talk about the situation on the continent of Africa right now. Africa, by contrast, is actually dealing with a population boom. In fact, some of the research tells us that the population in sub-Saharan Africa is expected to grow by 10 times if we look at the number in 1960 and what it's going to be in 2050. Is the continent ready to deal with that kind of population growth?
Yeah, well, thank you very much for having me here. Indeed, the population in Africa is growing rapidly, but very importantly, it's also very young. It has a median age, the population structure of around 19 years, which is the youngest around the world. So indeed, the population is growing and it is very, very young. And, you know, there's a pressure on policymakers, on decision makers on the continent to create meaningful and productive jobs for these young people. Around 13 to 15 million people join the labor market every year, right? So you've got young people, growing population, but also people needing jobs. And for the most part, these people cannot afford to stay unemployed, right? So many people are actually engaged in low-wage, low-paid, low-skilled, informal work. So indeed, there's a pressure on policymakers to do something about engaging meaningfully the vast majority of Africans.
So Zainab, as you say, you know, 13 to 15 million young people on the African continent coming onto the job market every year. And of course, the nature of the labor market is changing right now. A lot of people in Africa were involved in agriculture. A lot of people were involved and still involved in the service sector. But we're looking at a digital economy now. Is the education infrastructure on the continent going to be able to cope with that?
So this is a very valid question. And I think it's a question that our policymakers in different countries, but also at a more sub-regional and continental level, are grappling with, that there is indeed a need to think about overhauling educational systems to align with the current structure of labor markets, to align with the needs of labor markets. So certainly there's a need to think about the kind of training that young people get for the economies of today, which I think in the case of Africa, you've got a combination of an attempt to build industrial economies still, and there's still a small window of opportunity to do that. But also at the same time, we've got a new digital economy, right, around especially financial services, fintech, which is booming across the continent. So indeed, there's a need to think about the kinds of skills that young people get, because you have a situation in which in countries like Nigeria, Kenya, even South Africa, university graduates often joining the labor market and not getting jobs, and therefore ending up in jobs that are far below even some of the skills that they have acquired, because they need to they need to have a living. And also you've got a high rate of entrepreneurship actually across many African countries. Young people, whether those who have had formal education or those without formal education, go into entrepreneurship, set up their own businesses, because again, they need to survive. They need something to do. So there really is a need to think about the kinds of skills that people acquire.
Okay, we need to take a break right now. Stay with us. You're watching The Heat. We'll be right back.
The nature of business is to bring value. Business activities in Europe, Asia, and the U.S. reach consumers globally. Trade, manufacturing, energy, high-tech, real estate, consumption. We give an expanded view on global business and how it covers, influences, or relates to the whole world. Global Business, only on CGTN.
Welcome back. In this edition of The Heat, we're taking a look at countries opening the door to foreigners to fill job positions. Let's get back to our panel right now. Remy Pierre, you know, at the beginning of the show, Yoshikazu Kato was talking about all the challenges that Japan faces, and one of them right now, which is unique to this period that we're living in, of course, is the pandemic. COVID-19 has swept across the world. What about places like Europe? I mean, what kind of impact is this pandemic going to have? Not right now, but in the years ahead as well.
Well, definitely you're seeing right now numbers actually booming in terms of migration compared to 2020 and 2019, because those have been decreasing during the pandemics. But do you see a structural increase of migrations of, you know, people, especially, you know, from African countries trying to cross the Mediterranean up to Europe, and even, you know, from European countries going to England, which is usually the heaven that, you know, most of English-speaking migration wants to attend. That has fueled a series of populistic movements that led to Brexit, for example, or the Trump administration in the U.S., if you want to do a parallel. The issue here, and as I was mentioning, is that actually that nourishes a series of criminal activities of people that passed, you know, and organized the passing of the Mediterranean or the Channel. There's a lot of traffic going on. There's a lot of violence in areas where migrants are kept, unfortunately, and you have, you know, difficulties to try to organize this when there's a clear, at the individual level, a clear request and demands to have a better life. That's simple. Unfortunately, this is not met, even if we actually make the case that economically it makes a lot of sense to include, you know, more migrants coming in to be able to fuel the economy. This is not met by policies from different states to actually integrate and educate those migrants and make sure that they actually can become, you know, good citizens or integrate easily the job market or not have a series of social institutional problems. And actually, this would be in the best interest of everyone. And quite the opposite, you have a series of drama, as I was mentioning, of people dying in the Mediterranean or in the Channel, and a series of discontentment from, you know, population in countries that do not welcome population, that they do not see as integrated, that they actually do not see as sharing the same religion or racial background or others. And this is really used in favor of a series of ambitious politicians that just base, you know, their political platforms ahead of next elections towards on these claims.
William Lee, you know, as I said before, the immigration question in the United States has become very, very politicized. It's very, very divisive. But do you think there is a recognition among politicians, especially in the United States Congress, that this is a problem that faces the entire country, that they need to raise, you know, the issue above politics and look at it for what it is and change laws in this country?
Oh, absolutely. One of the issues that you've just talked about, difficulties of assimilation, sociological differences, understanding cultural differences, those have come about, have historically always been there, but they've been exaggerated and amplified these days because of illegal immigration, these waves of boat people who just wash up on the shores of Europe and suddenly have to integrate themselves to a different culture, a completely different culture and religion than they've lived with. Those adaptations can be handled with the proper policy and by legalizing the channels by which people can come. And we in the United States certainly over the centuries have welcomed educated and non-educated. My parents did not speak English. My father was a waiter, my mother's a seamstress, and I managed to somehow get a PhD in economics and become an economist. And so that story is repeated thousands and thousands of times. What we need to do is to have adequate assimilation policies that are legalizing different channels. The people who are here illegally have to find a way to become citizens as well. And I think the politicians are also having to work on that. And that's probably one of the greatest challenges, is how they take the stock of illegal immigrants and convert them onto a path of citizenship to legalize them. I think the Europeans are facing that problem in spades. Mm-hmm. But one of the problems they'll face in the future is that wave of migration from Africa, because the wave of migrants and young workers coming from Africa looking for jobs and opportunities, just the way they came to the United States, States hundreds of years ago will be affecting Europe much more so than the United States. But I think one of the things that we've learned from history is that policies can be put in place. Volunteer groups, government groups can help assimilate people. And I think the key now is to be able to draw up the right cooperation across countries to limit the flow to be manageable and how and develop means of managing the flow of people coming from one continent to another.
Yoshikazu, where does public opinion in Japan lie on the question of immigration? Is there widespread support for what the government's trying to do, albeit very temporary?
I think only 20-30% would support my immigration policy, or the Japanese government, our central government, should, you know, try to move on to, you know, absorb more, you know, migrated people, you know, whoever, you know, come to Japan to stay or, you know, come to Japan to work. But I think what I'm thinking about is, you know, if the COVID-19 could provoke our conservatism, you know, now actually the pandemic changes everything. You know, previously Japanese people was very stubborn to our conventional, you know, environment. You know, we need to be in office, we need to speak Japanese, we need to, you know, work among Japanese. But, you know, COVID, you know, actually created a new normal. So I think, you know, this is actually very much related with our immigration policy in the future. You know, if we could, you know, because it's a new normal, if we could adjust to a new normal to welcome more, you know, people, even there, you know, under the immigration policy, so-called, what I said, it's a kind of taboo in Japan over the years. But I think now, you know, it's a new stage. So I think more and more people would support our immigration policy or diversify our working place or working environment. This is the kind of process of our, you know, new adjustment in the post-COVID era. So this is what I'm thinking about in the future, looking forward.
Zainab, Usman, in Africa, I mean, a population boom can actually represent opportunities for the countries of Africa, couldn't they? But we're also seeing a phenomenon in Africa, which we see in other parts of the world as well, is that there's this move to the cities, great big, you know, movements of people, urbanization, in people in search of jobs, in search of a place to live in the city. These, of course, are placing heavy strains on the infrastructure of African cities. How are policymakers addressing that?
Yeah, so absolutely. I think there's a lot of intra-African migration, which is rural, urban in nature, as you just described. But I think it's also, you know, cross-border. You have people moving from one country to another. And in fact, in a survey done by Afrobarometer, I think, you know, more than a third, close to like 40% of African migrants actually moved to other African countries rather than moving from the continent of Africa to Europe or North America or other parts of the world. So policymakers, therefore, are thinking and should think even further about, you know, how to make migration work for the African continent. And, you know, one thing that has come up recently is the Africa Continental Free Trade Area, which is meant to really boost and strengthen regional integration among African countries, in addition to what already exists with some of the regional economic communities, such as ECOWAS in West Africa, which already has like a free movement of people and goods. So, you know, those mechanisms need to be strengthened further. And I think, you know, there are already initiatives on that front. But I think something very, very important also is around, you know, the non-tariff barriers to economic integration and trade, and this also affects migration, meaning the need for good connectivity infrastructure, electricity, definitely, but also very importantly, transport infrastructure, the roads, the bridges, the ports, the airports, but also mass transit infrastructure. Right. And then, of course, digital connectivity, digital infrastructure to enable people to communicate better. And then maybe very, very importantly, I'll also mention the need to reduce the transaction costs of remittances. So even among the African migrants, whether to other African countries or to other parts of the world, remittances, the money they send back home is actually quite important. For helping their families back home. But unfortunately, the transaction costs around the transfer of those finance of that money tends to be very, very high. So, you know, policymakers need to work with other parts of the world, actually, with money transfer services to reduce those transaction costs. I think those are some of the general policies that could further help African countries.
Rémi Pierre, there was an interesting observation made by a researcher at Rhodes College, which is in Memphis. And the researcher made the argument that immigration is not a solution for an aging population, and that migrants will also age, and their fertility rate will shift to that of the domestic-born population as well. Firstly, do you agree with that? And secondly, if that is the case, what's the alternative?
Well, I tend to disagree with this. I mean, especially because you actually see that most of the migrating population are the ones, you know, that actually make most children and actually do not kind of, you know, turn towards the classic, you know, rhythm of population and birth that, you know, of host countries. It takes a little time to arrive there. I think one thing also that we have to mention in this conversation is that most immigrants actually flee, you know, conflict areas. When you look at, you know, migrants coming to Europe, they're mainly coming from Eritrea, Sudan, Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, Iran, you know, countries where they have been facing a series of conflicts, and therefore they're just fleeing to see a better life. And this is bound to increase even more in the future with a series of climate change related conflict areas, desertification in Africa, gang violence, for example, in Central America. You know, most of the migration right now to the US is actually coming from Honduras, Guatemala, Nicaragua, Venezuela, areas that actually you see the lack of transparency and basic safety in countries that are, you know, ravaged by gang violence, and therefore there's no, you know, better option for those population to go to the US, to go to Europe. Then, you know, whether they actually, you know, tend to adopt the modes of lives of the of European populations or American population, whether we're looking at sociology or we're looking at, you know, the birth rates. This takes some time, and that's the whole idea of integrating them, so they actually, you know, are part of a common, you know, civilization objective and cradle. And I don't believe that, you know, the arrival of populations, you know, from Central America right. to the U.S. is that easily assimilated.
Okay, great conversation, but we have to leave it there. We have run out of time. Thanks to all of you for being with us. That's it for this edition of The Heat, but the conversation continues online. Join us on CGTN America's Facebook page to comment on this or any other show, or chat with us on Twitter. You can find us at CGTN America. I'm Arnand Naidu in Washington, D.C. Thanks for being with us.